Hey, welcome back everyone to another episode of Uncanny Mystic Minds. So for today, I have a special guest, Kiersten from Shamanic Activation. So we've been talking through it throughout the weeks, and she has, man, I just really like her, a lot of the stuff that she shares. She goes into like detail about certain like ritual type practices and concepts to help you empower yourself and learn about a lot of magical things pertaining to shamanism. So I've always had a thing for shamanism in terms of like a respect and a, like, I guess like a tie, like, God, man. I mean, I don't want to say, but maybe like a long time ago, maybe I was in that, like that. Like, that's like the kind of resonation that I have with it.
Yeah. And that's there for a reason. I mean, that's not there by accident either.
Yeah. And so, and then it was funny because around this time when I had bumped into seeing your stuff, mm-hmm. that was also the time when I literally was getting into like the beginning of just Norse mythology, which was brand new to me. I had never thought about it before.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, it's all kind of like, so it kind of all hit at once. So I really appreciated your stuff.
Thank you.
So welcome, Kiersten. Thank you for joining
me.
Yeah.
I'm so happy to be here. And I love all the content you share. It's amazing.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, right on. Yeah, I'm just chugging along, you know, just doing as it comes. And but it's nice because I'm starting to see things unfold a little bit, you know. Yeah. And it's cool, like I'm like in a journey now for real, like, like before I felt like I was kind of by myself a lot. Yeah. Like by and large, and now I'm like, oh shit, I'm not by myself.
No, you know? It's also divine, the timing, it's all perfect.
Yeah, for sure. I'll tell the people a small story that just kind of stuck out in my head.
Yeah.
Around the time that we had confirmed our booking, you know, I forget the exact time, but right when we confirmed it, I'm driving home at a stoplight, and then I look up at a billboard, and this is by my house, like a block from my house. Mm-hmm. So I know the billboard all the time because I'll know if it changed, because I'm there every day.
Sure, yeah.
And at this point, it changed. It was a brand new one, and it said Scandinavian Designs. It was like a, it said Mew Scandinavian Designs, and it was like a furniture thing, you know. But I was, but I always read into the clues of what's going on in my life.
Yes.
So
yes.
Like it's like leading me, like I'm getting led here. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, oh, you know. So I knew, like, you know, because like one of my big things that I get off on is like synchronicities, you know.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so I was like, okay, well, there's that. You know, so,
that's amazing. Yeah, it's just sure. That confirmation of like, oh, I'm going the right way. This is, it's all perfect. And you're so supported going that route.
Yeah. And like meant to be and, yes. And stuff like that. So then you feel kind of like, I guess like protected, or like you feel like the universe kind of like has your back in this regard, you know? So absolutely. I know you make moves like that. And I do my best to make moves like that accordingly, because, you know, I'm kind of tired of like wasting my time in a sense, you know, so
yeah.
So I try to do that, and that way it works out like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think having the awareness and having that, you know, attunement to the signs also is huge. Like you're so aware, like you can just tell, like you're really tapped in energetically. So you're open to receiving the signs, where someone might block themselves from even seeing the synchronicities, which I think is just the saddest thing. And I've definitely been there, so I know.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, it's a combination of some people could either be like stubborn, like maybe they're smart but stubborn, mm-hmm. or the other one is just like an aloofness of just kind of like you just actually have no idea like what's like behind you or around you, and so that happens too.
Yeah,
you know, depending on what's happened in your life, you know, like especially, you know, like traumatic things, because then it's like it'll give you weird blocks, like kind of like a weird tunnel vision. So then you're only like looking at a certain spot.
Yeah,
so,
absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, but tell the, if you don't mind telling the people a little bit about, I guess, what you do and in terms of like coaching and helping people out and kind of even what drew you in here a little bit.
Yeah, so I am a shamanic practitioner and a certified holistic health coach. So I was a health coach before I was a shaman, and I run my own shamanic healing practice. So I kind of fuse both the shamanism as well as the holistic healing together. And I feel so blessed to be on this path, and you know, it was worth all the turmoil, all the hard stuff, of course, but I really just focus on helping empower people to develop their own healing abilities, because we all have it. You know, I'm not special at all. You know, I'm just a facilitator for people. So everyone has the same capabilities, and it's just about tapping into that for them. And I personally healed myself of a lot of health problems, a really severe autoimmune illness, depression, anxiety, panic attacks. I mean, you name it, I was dealing with it, and completely healed myself with a shamanic lifestyle and shamanism. So now the fact that I get to do this for other people is just the greatest blessing. Like, I feel so lucky every single day.
That's so cool. You know, how you just said a second ago, facilitating the healing. I think that's like super crucial in terms of like healers speak. Like personally for me, that's kind of how I know what's up with someone, in terms of like if they're healers, and then it lets me know in terms of like how their ego is, or how their like their relationship with the ego.
Yes.
You know, and then so yours is like obviously like healthy, because you know you're facilitating it. You're like right. A bridge, and then you only go as so far as the bridge, as they want to extend the bridge.
Yes.
Yeah,
that's the perfect way to describe it. And I think, you know, shamanism itself is a bridge, and you're dealing with, you know, soul work. And that's truly, in my opinion, one of the most vulnerable, you know, areas of work that you can do is on the soul level. And so, like, you know, I said, it's just facilitating, you know, but spirit and the divine and all of our guides, they're doing the heavy lifting. And so is the client. You know, the person, like you said, they have to want it. They have to meet you there and open up. And then the possibilities are endless from that point.
So cool. Like when you say soul healing, like I'm not that versed in that. Like, I mean, I have my concept of soul, but when you say soul healing, like is that like more along the lines of like shadow work, or is it like its cousin, or is it a whole different thing?
Yeah. So that's a great question. It's shamanically speaking, it's a little bit different than what traditional shadow work content is out there right now. So shamanically speaking, the soul is, you know, it's of course in us. So it's really about following through our entire lifetime. So it's the deepest, deepest pieces of us. And it's whole, you know, we are born completely whole as a soul. But shamanically speaking, what they believe is that anytime we have a trauma, and trauma, I think, has a really scary connotation with it. People think trauma is really catastrophic events, which of course those are. But there's also the other traumas, and it's things like when we're children and say, you're a really sensitive child and you're screamed at by an adult, that is a trauma to your soul, essentially. And so a shaman believes any really sudden shock, any injury, anything that you're not expecting to happen, essentially that piece, that soul piece at that point in time will fragment off. So it's kind of like a piece of that soul stays in that point in time, and it doesn't evolve with the person as they evolve through their life. And it's not that they're broken or damaged or like it's missing forever, the soul, by any means. It's all about just reintegrating those pieces back into us now. And I do believe soul loss is one of the biggest problems in the world right now, is we go through our lives not properly dealing with traumas, and they accumulate, and then it takes a huge toll on our mind bodies. And you know, shamans believe that every single physical illness is rooted in on that soul level, on the energetic level, and there is a spiritual significance to that illness. So it's about dealing with it on the soul level, because when we get that deep soul healing, when we reintegrate that lost soul piece into the person now, they're completely empowered, they're completely reintegrated. Its possibilities are then endless. I mean, you think about being able to operate through life if you had no fears, no, if you weren't living with that trauma and carrying that day in and day out, you would be unstoppable and you wouldn't ever doubt yourself. So the possibilities with the deep soul healing is of course affecting our lives and how we treat ourselves and other people, but it's also affecting our physical health. And I think that's one of the most dramatic things is, you know, I've seen the most incredible, you know, situations with my clients where they've healed really heavy, heavy physical illnesses by doing the shamanic healing specifically. And they're not unique. You know, this is something, shamanism is 60,000 years old. So it's really the oldest holistic healing modality in the entire world. It's not a religion. And that's the other thing, is it's amazing because anyone can utilize shamanic healing. You do not need to have a certain set of beliefs. There's no intermediaries, no dogma. It's all about just embracing that universal divine soul healing, and anyone can do that. And I think that's a common misconception about shamanism.
That's there's like so like a freedom to that. You kind of relayed that last part. That's I like that a lot. Maybe that's why I have an affinity to that too. You know,
yeah. Well, and you may have ancestors too. I mean, that's the other thing. Shamanism isn't linked to just one culture, one location. All over the world, shamanism has been practiced for thousands of years. So you more than likely, I mean, all of us do have ancestors that were shamanic. And I definitely feel like there's something with you. There's a great energy, a healer. Like, it's a very specific energy you can tune into in that shamanic realm. That's really, like, I would definitely explore that on your end.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to. Maybe with your help a little bit.
I'm totally here. Absolutely.
Yeah, that'd be so cool.
That's my favorite, yeah.
Like, a little bit in the earlier part of your last talk right here, when you were talking about the soul stuff, I guess I like the word that came out in my head was like fragmentation.
Yes.
And so, and so I guess you gotta help like retrieve like your soul fragmented parts.
Yes. Absolutely. That is the perfect way to explain it. So
it is different than shadow work for sure. Yes. It's different. It's like it's similar, but it's its own, but it's different.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, in those shamanic sessions, you do have to confront some darkness. There is a lot of heaviness, and there is that same, you know, heavy just trauma sometimes that we have to also deal with shadow work. But mainly with shamanism, it's about just empowering that person to the best of our abilities at this point in time and doing that deep soul work.
Yeah, and that way you get to like the core of yourself, and then the core is like the truest part, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Without any of the wounding or the trauma, I mean, we can just be ourselves then and who we're meant to be.
Express yourself accordingly without like the glitchiness or like the blocks and stuff like that, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Cool.
Yeah.
Nice, man. Like, I guess when you were talking earlier,
It was probably long-winded.
No. It's just that I have these little things that kind of popped up in my head.
I love it.
I might as well just whip it out. And
yes.
So you were talking about like your clients, how they had miscellaneous things, as did you, like autoimmune. Yeah. I was thinking about like at that point, I was thinking about myself.
Really?
When I hit 30, prefacing in my 20s and even late teens, I loved bagel and cream cheese. That was like my go-to breakfast, you know, twice on Sunday type of thing, you know. But like,
awesome.
I was very well, like basically at least 5 days a week I'm eating that.
And
then with a lot of cream cheese. And so once I hit 30, the cream cheese, ice cream, cheese, pretty much almost most cheese.
Yeah.
And yogurt, it was like thrashing me so bad, like where my skin, like I have like controlled eczema, especially like from a kid, you know, so I have like my cream and stuff, but this was not eczema. It was like, I don't even know what it was. And I was going to, I don't know, I went to 4 doctors or something and they couldn't help me. They were like, they tried, but they could not help me at all. And then I was just like, oh man, like what's going on? And I was with this for a couple of years, and at this point I tried doing like the gluten-free thing, and it was really nasty. Like it was like it wasn't like eczema, but it was like inflamed, like really bad, like inflammation, and it was just looked kind of it looked crazy, and it was all over. And I was like, what's going on? And so obviously I cut the dairy, but it was still like I still had my problem. Mm-hmm. And through a lot of like I just call it internal work.
Mm-hmm.
And then I guess from that there's spiritual concepts, but also like taking care of your body physically. So I just try to do like whatever I could, like everything I could, right? And I ended up getting better. And then
really?
I realized, yeah,
wow.
I realized it's like it has to do with like your aura and your energy. And so, and then you can, the only way to kind of manipulate that is you have to keep going inside as deep as you can go.
Absolutely.
And that's kind of what helped me out with that. Yeah, I've had a lot of different things that have happened to me over the years, like traumatic, like physically, like getting injured, or just different things that happened to me physically or whatever. And so I ended up like healing a lot of myself, you know. Wow. Like, I'm not gonna say that I'm fully healed, blah blah blah, but
yeah,
you know, I'm still on this journey, but
yeah,
I've healed myself so much, like a lot. And so I definitely know that you can do this stuff, and
yes,
you can empower yourself. And even if doctors don't know what's going on with you, or if people mm-hmm. think you're like a lost cause, it's if you do it, if you believe you can, or have and faith and hope, you know, you can make it pan out.
Absolutely. And I, you know, doctors told me I was having a lot of neurological symptoms. So this was a few years ago now. My legs were going numb. I was having, like, losing my vision. I was passing out nonstop, at least once a day for a long time. I was having just
crazy,
so many,
passing out.
Yeah. I would have huge, like, bruises on my head from hitting. It was just really, really bad. And I felt like I was dying, like my internal self was dying. And it sounds so dramatic and just over the top, but I didn't know how else to compare it to. And doctors diagnosed me with MS, which is a degenerative disease, an autoimmune illness that they don't believe there's a cure for. So they were like, this is something you're gonna have to live with. Your health is only gonna go downhill from here. You'll probably be in a wheelchair. And I mean, it was devastating. And I was, there's just something in me though, and I know without a doubt it was spirit that was just planting this little seed of like, there's something else going on. There's something deeper. And for me at least, it was so much unresolved trauma that I was not dealing with. That was just taking this huge toll internally, and eventually your body just breaks down. And that's something with the soul loss, is our physical body cannot maintain that for long periods of time without it breaking down. And just as much as it can break down, we can build it up. And so through shamanic healing specifically, and really embracing a shamanic lifestyle, and like you said, like making those changes in your lifestyle are just as important as doing the inner work and making those shifts, you know. And it's just really, I think, the deepest work we can do. And then the physical stuff, it kind of takes care of itself. It's a lot easier to make those lifestyle changes. I don't know if you experience that same thing, like as you've been on this journey, it's kind of like easier to tune into your body and just know.
Yeah, like now I have more like my willpower in terms of like my control, or like,
yes,
self-restraint, you know what I mean? Like I can, like before, like say with drinking alcohol, I would be more binge drinking and all,
yeah,
that stuff.
Yeah.
And then so now I have a lot more control over myself, where I can plan myself out and stuff like that.
That's,
yeah,
amazing. Did you usually utilize shadow work? Was that your biggest thing when you were first kind of started?
Well, geez, before I knew about shadow work, I guess I was starting to do this already.
Yeah.
And Reiki. Yeah, before
Reiki,
before I got into learning about Reiki and shadow work, I guess I was already doing this on my own by myself,
mm-hmm,
in my room.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I always had a thing for that. And
yeah,
then with Reiki, I will obviously use my hands.
Mm-hmm.
And I just I don't know. I didn't know what I was doing, but I had definitely had my hands on myself, and I wouldn't leave the spot until I felt like it was okay to leave the spot.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And that was just a natural, like, instinct?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, like,
that's amazing.
I guess, yeah. This was before I got, like, did classes and, like, had attunements and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then with the shadow work, I guess, like, for me, a lot of it was the mirror. That's how I got with that. And so that thing could be, like, there's like some kind of freakiness or magic stuff, whatever you want to call it, components to using the mirror. You can see a lot of shit, and then you can make it come out, and then you can see what like monsters have been lurking or something like that inside yourself.
Yeah,
and so,
yeah.
I guess I would use a mirror, you know, in terms of what I was doing, I was looking and kind of staring, but I would have like a stare in a way where I could tap into myself. And then the other one was kind of how people talk about seeing auras, like they'll kind of make their eyes like unfocus in a way, and it kind of like a relaxed unfocus,
yeah,
but you're still looking there. And so I guess I would do that to help me with that.
Wow.
Too. Yeah. And
that's incredible though, that was so intuitive. I mean, you know, that's probably not the first time you've done this then, because that is,
yeah, I know, right?
Yeah,
because I was just by myself in my room, and
yeah,
like no other way to, you know, like there's no,
yeah,
other way to go, I guess. And so I just was, I guess, experimenting, but I was just doing kind of what felt good.
Yeah.
Or, I don't know. Yeah, I was doing that. Yeah.
That's amazing.
So like, if you could tell people like, how did you even get into shamanism in a sense? Like, where, like, did you see something, or did you have a crew, or did you go to an event, or like, what kind of catapulted that whole thing?
Yeah. So I believe that it was all in divine timing of, you know, I was in the deep, dark depths of that illness. I could barely get out of bed every day. It was really, really bad. And so I think I had to be at this point where I was so desperate that I was almost more aware of what was going on around me. So I came across, I kid you not, like a singular sentence online talking about a wounded healer, that archetype. Mm. And shamanically speaking, the wounded healer is someone who has entered their own death, illness, madness, and come out of it through the help of spirit. So, and because they've healed themselves, then the spirits are like, you need to heal other people. So then they help you heal other people who are going through the same thing. And it was just a visceral physical response reading this wounded healer line of, oh my, this is it. Like, so I just deep dived into shamanism. And then, I mean, long story short, I was really lucky enough to train one-on-one with a shaman of over 30 years experience. She was just one of the most powerful people I've ever met. She was incredible. So I was really, really lucky to train with her. And I kind of just started, you know, working on people that I knew around me and just exploring on myself, of course, first. And once I was able to heal, I mean, I have no symptoms now. I feel amazing physically. My vision is perfect. I don't pass out anymore, no neurological signs. So, and I wouldn't believe it if I hadn't gone through it. So I think that was why Spirit was like, you need to go through this, because it sounded so crazy. I mean, looking at it from the outside, I'm sure people are doubting, but I'm the living proof that there's something to this. And so I was just like, this just purpose was set in motion of like, I need to help other people access the same healing power in themselves. Cause so many people are suffering with the same things, and it doesn't need to be that way. And I think that was, it's just kind of lit this fire of like, you know, needing to educate people as much as possible to help them heal.
Yeah. You realize there's other ways, and then it's possible. And then at this point you could actually help facilitate the spread.
Yes. You know? Absolutely.
Yeah. I think that must be what, besides like the Norse stuff and shamanism, like the wounded healer thing, that has to be it. Because for me personally, I never explored that too much. But when I heard the terms, I obviously knew with this life that was obviously it for me.
Yeah.
I've talked about it before. I forget where, but I've mentioned before that I must have karma from Atlantis, like where I just really know that. And it's funny because like it makes me want to like it just like it's very heavy. And so I know that they like something happened with the grids.
Interesting.
Yeah. And like, so you know how the planets have grids?
Yeah.
And so something happened where the grids got manipulated, you know, probably through some kind of like dark magic or God knows what like that. And so the grids got like hijacked, so to speak. And so instead of curving like how it's supposed to curve on the original ley lines or what have you,
yeah,
like the chakras of the world, it got twisted and distorted. And so whatever that shit is, I'm in that, like I'm tied to that. And so now in this life, I have to unwind and untwist my distortions and untwist myself. And the stuff that's happened to me, it's been physical, like where, like this one time I got, and I knew it was probably because of this in my past karma, where I got beaten up really, really, really bad, where I was like unrecognizable and I was supposed to go to a hospital. And I think like I had things shattered on my face Wow. Shattered or broken, I don't know, whatever you want to call it, but along my face. And my family obviously wanted to take me to the hospital. I needed to go to a hospital. And then my stubborn ass, I don't know what was going on with me, but my stubborn ass, I didn't want to go. And blah, blah, blah. And then so for years, I was fucked up from this where you could tell that something really happened to me. Like I was in a, like you could tell physically that I was in a bad accident. Mm. Like people don't know what happened to me, but it was obvious. And then so through healing, also chiropractic work and massage. Yeah. You know, I'm not gonna leave that shit out. So yes. Without that, that also helped. But I never went to like I should have gotten surgeries for this shit.
Yeah.
Like big time. Those facial surgeries or whatever. Mm-hmm. I should have been at the hospital getting probably those.
Probably.
Yeah, like that. And but between myself with energy stuff and shadow work as well and chiropractic and massage, I feel a lot better. I know like I'm still like I'm never gonna be perfect per se, but I feel perfect enough like where I feel like fairly healed. Like I'm where I can say I'm really happy and I can say that freaking like I have no regrets now. And then now I know that it's a part of my deal for that wounded healer thing, because how I got good at Reiki and all this stuff was I did it to myself because I needed it.
Yeah, exactly.
And then, yeah. So from there I could help other people and, you know, accordingly, but it happened because of me and then all my, like my karma, if you will. And so it's all tied together, but it's like I needed it and it had to happen and it was a part of my, you know, destiny. And,
yes.
And here we are now, you know.
Yeah. I mean, looking back, it makes so much sense. But in the moment, I mean, I was not seeing that. I wasn't seeing some grander plan. But then looking back, you're like, wow, that all makes so much sense now. Because looking at you, I never would have got like at all.
Oh my God. Like when it first happened, it was scary. Holy shit. Yeah. Like scary, scary.
That is really scary.
Yeah. It was wild. Ew, yeah. Crazy. Yeah. And what I think about is that you're like, you know, that saying, like for a team, like a sports team, you're only as strong as your weakest link, like that type of thing. So that goes for the individual too. Yeah. So your weakness is your power is tied into your weakness. And so that's why we're like wounded like that, because we have healer in us.
Yes.
And so that's how that's the correlation.
Oh, 100%.
There was no other way to be a strong healer if you weren't able to like rise from the ashes, if you will.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And shamanically speaking, I mean, there is no shaman out there, you know, truly in their power that has not been through really, really tough trials and initiations. I mean, they have been through, and really healers in general and light workers, you know, I've met some incredible Reiki workers too, where they have been through it. And that's the only way they could be this incredible healer for other people.
Yeah. Straight up with like Dark Night of the Soul type of thing. Like I thought before hearing this, those phrases, I thought it was just my life. I'm like, why am I the only one going to this? And no one else freaking, like everyone else is in La La Land or like, they have like no karma. With me, as soon as I do one bad thing, it's like, boom, I get hit with it immediately.
Yes.
Why am I the only one getting hit by karma immediately? And then I go through all the dark nights of the soul, like paradigm shattered, life shattered. Like, what? But apparently I'm not, you know, I'm obviously not the only one. That was just how I felt at the time.
Well, yeah, and I feel like it also wasn't talked about even like 5 years ago, like that, you know, that vernacular was not talked about. Like,
yeah, it's like
on nearly as much.
Yeah, it's like on the newer side than not.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's like, but it's true, like with the whole weakness is your, like your power is in your, like your strength is tied into the weakness in a way. It's like with me, I feel how I get a lot of like whether I'm like working out or just or doing anything, like obviously like with meditation and yoga things or dancing, anything, I feel like my power is like in my air, like in my air element. Mm-hmm. And like in my astrological chart, God knows I'm so dominated by air. It's like I barely have any of the rest. Yeah.
Wow.
I'm super airy. And that's why I'm like Libra and I have like Venus and all my stuff. But I, besides having eczema, controlled eczema as a kid, the main thing that I had as a little kid was asthma.
Oh.
And so I would have to go to the hospital like a couple times a year, you know, take the like the little nebulizer machine and all that. So and even now I deal with this every day where I have to have my inhalers, I get a, you know, have to do all that stuff, right? And I personally know, I mean, I just know that when I do leave this world physically, when I do die, it's going to be because of a lack of oxygen. I know that. I just kind of know it, right?
Yeah.
But the thing is, I know that my strength and my power is in my air, because when I, like, utilize my air and harness my air through, like, different techniques and just, like, whatever I feel is right, and I guess a lot of it's tied to yoga, basically, like some kind of yoga. That's where, man, like I'll get really clear messages, or I'll excel really good in physical work.
Wow.
Yeah, and so it's like a testament. It's like, yeah, well, it's because I have asthma. Like, it's tied to that, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, just even having that awareness is so powerful, though, because you're fully then. I mean, you're using it and using, like you said, that weakness as a power is everything. That could literally transform someone's life if they just shifted their perspective that way.
Yeah, because they kind of hold hands a little bit in a weird relationship. And then so, well, I guess even like, I don't want to say yin and yang, but you know, in yin and yang, there's a little bit of one in the other.
Yes.
So it's like, you kind of have to like cross, you have to cross into them.
Absolutely.
And then you'll find the relationship. And so that way I don't hate myself for having like asthma like that, you know, because I gotta, you know, like I have to take my medicine somewhat frequently. Like it's under control, like where I don't go to a hospital, but
I still
have to deal with this for sure. You know what I mean? Like I took my post before our stream right now, and you know what I mean? Like it's a part of the lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know,
Well, and that's heavy to deal with, I think, on a daily basis.
I guess, yeah. You know, I came to terms with it. It was like, all right, well, I'm probably gonna die, like, you know, later on like this, you know, in terms of like a lack of oxygen. Like it might be tied to that, you know.
Yeah.
So unless some like freak accident happens. but as of the way my body is, like that's where my weakness is, and then therefore my power.
Absolutely, by far. And I think a lot of people underestimate their own power and underestimate what they're capable of. And like we were talking about earlier about being a facilitator, no one's more powerful than you at healing yourself. And those people, they are merely triggers. Like they are triggers for you to heal yourself. They're not healing you. They're not doing it to you. You know, you need to bring that, like that's you. And I think that is the most empowering place to be and operate from, because then you're unstoppable at that point. And I think that's, people underestimate their abilities really often, and it's just heartbreaking to see.
Yeah, you know, we're in the what do you call it, like when people are in a war, like in, and there's the trench.
Yes.
We're in the trenches, you know. That's for sure. So you see like a lot of casualties and like a lot of like things affiliated with warfare.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely.
It could be ugly for sure.
Yeah. Know? And that takes a toll on our mind, body, and spirit, truly. I mean, that wears us down day in and day out.
Yeah. You could be desensitized. That was something that I had let myself deal with, you know, like say, for example, what comes to mind, driving in San Francisco and downtown, and there's a certain exit, a certain avenue that leads you into the main downtown, and it's called 6th Street. And so in this area, on that little strip of 6th Street going into the downtown, you see it all, man. You see all types of sad shit. Bums and people with syringes everywhere, and just all types of melee and all that stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And so in my 20s, because I was used to it being around here, I had desensitized myself to it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I noticed several years ago, I don't know how many years ago, but let's just say several, that I was like, oh, like I'm feeling compassion now again for like, even though like it is what it is out there. But before it was like, I knew I was like desensitized to it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then now I actually realize like, it's like a balance to have compassion, but still not let the stuff like get to you like that.
Absolutely. And you're protecting yourself, and that's completely normal. And I think that is a great way to view soul loss, is it's not something terrible that happens, it's really a protective mechanism. And that's what it comes down to for a lot of our behaviors, is we're trying to protect ourselves and protect our spirit. And sometimes, like going through war zones, I mean, it takes putting the blinders on to just survive yourself. So I think really being compassionate with yourself and knowing I can't help every single person, which is hard, you know, especially for, I know someone like you who has such a great like healer energy and wants to help people as much as you would like to, you know, you can't heal everyone that you come in contact with.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's like the, you can call it like a harsh truth or, you know, something like that. But yeah, it's like a bittersweet and it is what it is. But in the end, it's like, all right, well, all I can do is freaking learn from this.
Yeah, absolutely. It.
Like that's all I can do. And then when you get into situations where you're like, there's some kind of healing going on or whatever, I take it as like themes, like where this is a theme that I needed. And then, so I try to tie it to me like, okay, well, what is this telling me about me that as a theme that I got to like check? Like, what if I keep bumping into people that have the same type of emotional thing? That maybe there's something about my emotions that like, why do I get triggered with that type of emotion? Like, you know, kind of like that. And so I try to tie it into that now, cause that's all I can do, man. You know? And, I mean, I do try to affect the ones closest to me, you know, as much as I can, but at the same time, everyone has to do their own stuff on their own.
100%. And you just can't force it on anyone. And, you know, it's just not even ethical to do that at all. I mean, it really needs to be coming from them. But then when they're ready, they're usually really ready and really open. And they can see, oh, I had to go through all of this in order to be at this open place. Like people who go to you for healing, they're probably like, do whatever you need to, like, I'm ready. And they're sent to you for a reason. There is some mirror there. There's some lesson on each side. And the fact you have that awareness, I think, is what makes a really powerful healer.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. No lie detected here, you know? Yeah, it's, yeah, so that's what it is, man. So I'm interested in what you got to say about things that have to do with trances, trance, because there's a lot to that. And I like that kind of stuff. Like just how I like ways to energize yourself through air. There's something, a lot of stuff. I just don't, I guess I don't know the too much of the linguistics, but there's something to this trance stuff. And as a teenager in my later teens, that's when I started like with music and stuff, because you mentioned depression earlier. Oh my God, was I the most depressed kid? Like I had a good, like a pretty good childhood, like where I couldn't complain that much. But when all the other kids were happy about this and that, or going on a field trip to, you know, to the swimming pool or this and this and that, or if we had a outdoor ed, which is like you're going camping, and they're all so gung-ho about it and this and that, and I was just so emo about it. I was like, I would kind of hide it, but I was never like, I was always like depressed or something. And I was like always waiting to grow up. I was like, nah, I just want to be a grown-up, man. I don't want to deal with this shit. Yeah. It was something. And then I didn't even like music. Like all kids, you know, in preteens and early teens, they would like music. I still didn't even like music.
Wow.
That's how much, like, that's how out there I was. I was so aloof and so, like, emo or something. And then once I finally started getting into music, maybe in my mid to later teens, that's when I realized, oh, there's, like, something, like, fancy about life. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I had this one poster in my room that I had bought at a smoke shop, and it was a, it was black and white, and it looked like you were going into like a vortex, right?
Oh,
and it was very, it had like that 3D like imagery where if you kind of move to the side, it keeps moving.
Oh, that's so cool.
And so I would like use it. Even people, even my friends who would come in my room would freak out on it too. And you like play music, and then you look at your little poster, or even just by yourself, you know. And then I noticed that there was once I, because that was when I first started to like music, you know, around 15, 16. And then so I knew there was something to that, like with the music. And then later on, and I forgot what age, but let's just say my 20s, then I found out about the drums. You know, holy shit, like a live band, when there's like a live band, and then the drummer was always my favorite, hands down, in a live band. I was like, there's something about the drummer. And so I definitely have an affinity to trance, and because you can I feel like it's like you meditate, but like you get to like instant meditation, where like in a regular meditation when I'm by myself, like all quiet to try to get to my silence, it that could be more of a process, at least for me.
Absolutely. But,
tell me what you think about like trance stuff, or maybe your experience with that, or what you like.
Oh my gosh. It's one of my favorite things to talk about. I think it's one of the most underutilized, like, spiritual tools, if you will. And I think anyone can do it. And I would actually, like, what I recommend people start with, someone who is from, like, square one, if they have that monkey mind going on, sitting down for a 20-minute silent meditation would not work. I mean, their mind would just be going nonstop. So if someone really struggles kind of calming those thoughts, and I was that person, I'd like just manic thinking nonstop, didn't sleep, going. Meditating was really hard for me. But with drumming, what's incredible, and shamans have known this for thousands of years, I mean, the drum is the main instrument that shamans use to enter the trance state. And the trance state is how we enter the spirit realms as a shaman. So it's how we alter our state of consciousness. And we do that through drumming. And I always recommend people just listen to a drumming track of 200 to like 220 beats per minute. And they just turn that on, close their eyes. I always recommend an eye covering just to block out any light, and just like go silent and tune in. And what's amazing about the drumming is it actually creates a theta brainwave state in us. It's like a physiological override in our bodies, in our brains, where it kind of automatically zens us out. It's like we then almost like can't fight it, because it's just biology then. It really just physiologically overrides anything. So it's amazing for meditating and for quieting the mind. And then eventually you can go to the spirit realms using drumming. It's, I think, one of the easiest ways for people to be introduced to the divine and touching into that energy in those spiritual realms. It's one of my favorite things to recommend to people.
So dope. Like, how you said it overrides, and then, you know, what was it, 200 to 220? Is that what?
Yeah. And Apple Music has one that you can listen to. And then I have some free, like, on my YouTube channel, but there are a ton out there where you just want to be a faster rhythm. And that is what creates the theta.
And that's, like, very scientific.
Yes.
Like, how you were explaining that and how it overrides, and then the theta waves. Like, it's like, well, like, there's science to that.
There too. Is.
Like, and so, it, like, that's. That's super cool. That's like straight up magical. You know what
it
I mean?
It is.
The science with the energy like that.
Absolutely. But dancing is the other just energy. Like, I think that is such an underutilized tool for people if they could tap into that energy of the dance and the music. I mean, it sounds like it cracked you wide open, really finding music.
Yeah. Music cracked me at 15, 16. And then at, I think I want to say 20 years old is when I saw when I got introduced to like to dancers.
That's awesome.
And then some of them try to, you know, I had like different type of mentors and friends. Mm-hmm. And then so it just like, it gave me like that inspiration. You know how, I guess, like those old, like those stories that you hear about, like kind of like people that were going to jail a lot or doing these type of, you know, bad things or quote unquote bad things, and then they found something that made them want to like leave the street life. I guess kind of how I felt about that. I'm not sure where I would have gone if I didn't. It gave me like a type of inspiration to really want to do like a real passion.
Yeah.
Because before that, I was like, hey, I still don't like. I knew I didn't have a passion in a sense. Like I still was waiting. Like I was still waiting for that.
Yeah.
And then, so that helped me out to teach me about passion, and then how to jump into things and then really be all about it. And then that makes the concept of growing yourself, because prior to that, instead of growing myself with, which I consider like a little bit more like left-handed, before that I was super right-handed, where I was all about teamwork, where I would end up being the martyr. Or like I would end up kind of sacrificing myself to a point where I would end up being some kind of like a doormat to an extent if someone wanted to take advantage of that. You know, so I learned that as a kid, of all about the unification of teamwork. And then, but later on through passion, I realized that there's internal worlds, and then you can make yourself do your best to make yourself the best version of that. And then that's what introduced me also to like magical concepts or magical thinking. even though I didn't know it at that time, but that's what it was.
It's so cool because it just really sounds like energetically it opened up your channels. So it was like the dance and the music allowed things to flow and allowed that to yourself. It gave you that passion, and then you want to experience things more deeply and look at things more deeply when you have that passion.
Yeah, it ended up giving me like helping out with like character.
Yeah.
Like a strength of character. It helped with that for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. Well, I know besides the wounded healer stuff like that, I know this is recently with me getting into like the Norse stuff, because I never really tripped off that. I was diving into other things, and but man, it was freaky. This one month, it just wouldn't leave me alone.
They wanted you. They were gonna come no matter what.
Yeah. Where I was like, oh my god, like yes. I should have written this shit down. But it was like, well, that's why I bought a journal now, because so I could be able to. Yeah, I just recently ordered it because I'm like, I have to write all this shit down. Like, yes. These things happen to me. Like yesterday morning, I had to buy a new battery for my car because the day before my car didn't want to start. So I got to buy a battery. So I bought a battery, and that morning yesterday, Saturn was, the Saturnian archetype was, we were definitely just very together, and I kept getting, like the universe kept talking me through Saturn. That's how I feel the archetype. And so I was like, damn, I gotta write this shit down. But I was like driving. So like, you know, I wasn't gonna obviously do that, you know, but for moments like that, you know, and then how I got into the Norse stuff, it was like a month of these things going on and all these coincidences that kept leading back there. And I was like, at first, the first week or two, I didn't mind it that much because I just wasn't into it. Mm-hmm. And then it kept like winking at me, and I was like, okay. And so here, let me show you my
I want to see
it right here. So now I got this bad boy. So it's like,
oh,
cool.
I love that.
Yeah, it looks kind of like Indiana Jones.
Yeah, that's, you know? Sweet. I love that.
Yeah. And so because I wouldn't call myself like a magician like that per se, but I'm into magic, and I know a part of that, a big part of that is writing stuff down, like all these things. I should be like noting these things, and then things that I do or things that I observe. Like I gotta start acting like a little scientist or something like that.
Yeah,
like, something that I gotta start getting deeper into.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's what I noticed. That all people that I look up to, they definitely make that a thing for sure.
Yeah. There's a lot of power, I think, in especially using like pen or pencil to paper and physically writing, even over typing. I found that can be really impactful to even
100.
Just change. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, when I do certain writings, like at first, I was doing it on my phone app. Like I had like this notepad thing. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, I was like, there's something with my creativity that gets slightly staunched.
Same.
When I do it with a pen, there's something like I feel like I'm able to channel it a little bit better.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I guess that just, there's something about that, of you writing it yourself.
Oh, 100%. And I think the energy is really powerful to put it on paper. You're really bringing it into form that way, which it's at least for runes, specifically how you write them is important, of course, but even the energy and the intention that you're writing them with. I mean, the intention is everything in that, and in that concentration, because really what we're trying to do is harness the specific energy of that rune. So the best way to do that is really tap into the intention and the feeling of it. And that's key. I mean, from that point on, you're golden.
Yeah, that's super magical, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. And it's funny because I feel like I hear that a lot with runes. Is it something that initially people aren't as interested in, but then it keeps coming back over and over and over, and you know, just keeps coming in, and it's like, okay, I guess I have to pay attention now. And for me, it happened actually I was months into my shamanic journey, and I was doing a session. So I was in a trance state, and I had a Norse ancestor come to me and tell me all about the runes. And I was like, runes? I was like, what are you talking about? Yeah, my mom, she's 100% Norwegian pretty much. So I grew up in like a Scandinavian town, but as a teenager, I was like, I don't care really about like this. I don't care about my heritage. Come to find out, I mean, the runes, like the Norse used the runes for all kinds of magic and just incredible things. So of course it's full circle now, but she really instructed me on the runes and how to use them. And then it just set me on this path. But they are, I believe, one of the most underutilized tools for people. I mean, you can really create specific outcomes by harnessing these incredible symbols. And they're definitely not just an alphabet. There's a lot of like esoteric wisdom in each one.
Yeah, it's like its own thing.
It is. Yes.
I mean, it is like an alphabet, but I don't even think about it like that. About it like as a, it's like messages and like it talks and, yeah, it's super cool,
absolutely,
man.
It's how the divine talks through. I mean, it's how we can connect with that side and with spirit. I mean, it's really powerful, and there is that depth to it.
I had gotten my first set of runes, right? And when I got them, they're right here. So, I had got them. I had kind of blessed them in my way, and I slept. Like basically with them. I didn't want them on my actual bed, but I have them like right next to me, like on my little drawer. Mm-hmm. And that night, I don't remember the actual dream, but I had such a, the word is primordial.
Wow.
That's the word, like very primordial energy. And it was like very strong. And it was like, whoa. And I felt like, like in my dream. And I was like, what? Like, and I woke up and I was like, oh, it's the runes. Like, because I just woken up.
Wow.
I was like, oh my God. And so it makes sense that it's super old, right? And then that's why I felt the super old energy. Like, that's why I said it was like primordial. It was different. Yeah.
Absolutely. That is so cool though.
Yeah, totally.
You don't remember the dream itself?
No.
Just the energy?
Yeah. It was like an energy, and then it was like you couldn't, almost like you couldn't see it.
Yeah.
But it was like super old, super primordial, and super strong.
Yeah. That sums up the runes right there. I mean, it's that deep old energy. And like you said, a life of its own. It does have its own spirit, and there's a lot of power behind it.
Yeah. And it was, I had a natural connection with my set, with the runes, because... I like tarot too. I'm getting into tarot actually as we speak more now with like books and stuff. But to be honest, I was still grasping it. Like it was almost like I was still catching the concepts of the tarot. Mm-hmm. With the runes, it was not like that. Mm-hmm. It was damn near instant.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh my God. And
absolutely.
Yeah. So I love runes for sure. I've been... I'm all over the damn place. So like I said, I've been like reading about tarot and all that stuff, but but the runes is something special for me.
Absolutely. I feel 100% the same way. And it's interesting because tarot was actually inspired by runes and with rune symbols and rune magic. Mm-hmm. So it is similar to the rune magic you can use. But for me, it wasn't the same kind of depth where I connected with tarot the same way as the runes at all. Remembering with the runes, if that makes sense. It was like, this is something old. Like I have been here before. I've used these before. There's something here.
Yeah. Like, so runes are definitely older than tarot cards, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay. Cause I've slept with tarot cards too, right? Mm-hmm. I've had them in the same spot and it wasn't like I never got a thing like that yet, or at least yet per se, but I could not, there are certain dreams that I've never shook. Like, one was that one with the runes. Another one was where I saw like a demented, it was like, I have an episode about it where like, I call it the demented dentist demiurge, where I saw like the demiurge and I started to understand the psychoticness of it, like where someone is Looney Tunes or whatever. And another one as a kid was, it just never left me. And I kind of know the symbolism of it now, but it never left me, where I was at the top of a mountain, but it was just my one foot that was on the peak. Mm. And then I like, you know, looked over a little bit and that was it. And I started falling all the way down. And then when I, and I felt falling all the way down, and then I woke up, and that was one of the ones as a kid, you know.
Wow, that was as a child. That's so incredible. It stuck with you.
Yeah, never left, and I can still kind of like see it, kind of wow. like the demiurge one. Like there's a, because I obviously dream damn near every night in terms of I remember a little bit, but not that mm-hmm. much. Like mm-hmm. it'll be kind of hazy or in and out, and but like that one with the runes, it was just like I've never felt. Like pretty much primordial is just like the best way.
Yeah. Right. That's the perfect word for it though.
Yeah.
Yeah. Straight and up. I think working with runes, like the deeper you go and really focusing on the energy of each one, you know, I see almost all the time, one of the most common side effects of that is the dreams. It really mm-hmm. like, it escalates those a lot. And a lot of people who maybe haven't dreamed for most of their life, they'll start doing rune work. And it is like the craziest, most vivid experiences in the astral realm where it's the runes. I mean, they really allow for deeper exploration.
Yeah, that's so cool, man. Yeah, like I love your videos.
Thank you.
That you have, you'll have different types of things and they're creative and they're cool.
Oh,
and it's like, and they're practical too. Like that's what I like about it.
Thank you.
Because, yeah. And so like, that's something that I feel that a lot of people could gravitate to and utilize, you know what I mean? Because there's a practicality to it, but there's also the main parts, and the main parts are how you said, like the intention,
yes,
and like the way that you do it.
Absolutely. That means so much though, because that's really, I think one of the most important things is to make it accessible to people where it's also not expensive. It's not very complicated. There aren't a million steps. And you know, we need to apply this ancient wisdom, I believe, to modern life. I mean, we're adapting and evolving as a human species, and I think it'd be a disservice to our ancestors to not utilize this magic now and apply it how we can with this technology and these tools. So that really means a lot. Thank you for saying that.
Yeah, for sure. You know, because obviously now with all the, you know, the all the technology we got, you know, by and large, everyone is rolling into artificial life in terms of where we want to be. You know, a lot of people would just rather be in some type of technology or things that are technology based. So with this, it's like you can help get in tune with yourself, like with nature, and there's a huge, you know, like in an organic way.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's your birthright. I mean, we're all shamanic in nature. I'm a firm believer of that. Shamanism is heart-based and it's nature-based. And it's just who we are as souls and beings on this planet. Like we are supposed to effortlessly connect to nature and our heart and live in reverence of all of life and each other. And I'm a firm believer that everyone is capable of that.
Yeah. So beautiful. Yeah. It's so nice, man. Yeah. Well, is there anything that you'd like to let the people know before we kind of wind down? Is there anything that you, any kind of messages or anything like that, that you just kind of want to let them know real quick?
Yeah, I think the most important thing and what's coming in right now is don't underestimate yourself or your mystical abilities and what you're capable of healing and accomplishing, and don't settle for the life that... Just don't settle. I think that is such an important concept, is like you deserve to have the life of your dreams and you're capable of doing it. It's just about tapping into it, but everyone can.
Yeah. That's a lot of real strength, because everyone wants, it's so easy to give up, you know, and I understand, dude, like I totally get it.
Absolutely.
You know? And it's like people, whether it was a heartbreak or whether they, you know, are unsatisfied with the job or they feel like they have no direction. And then it leads people to keep isolating themselves. And then that's where you get kind of like a brooding mind, where your mind is brooding.
Yeah.
And then that stuff can lead to dark places.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And it takes a little bit of everything to help yourself in that way, to have the strength to not give up and to not settle.
Absolutely.
Like that, and then feel your worthiness. You know, that was one big thing that I had realized, I guess in my 20s or so, in my maybe mid or later 20s, that I was like, oh my God, like I've been feeling so unworthy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
And it's like, I didn't even know.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like, okay, like, it's weird too, because I'm the type of person that I don't want to give myself the false insinuations that I'm so high and mighty or this and that. But like, I had to find the right way for myself, so even so I could be a believer that I'm worth it of whatever I believe I'm worth.
100%. And I think that's what a lot of people, especially healers that I see a lot with clients, is they struggle with feeling worthy enough or healed enough to help other people. It's like they think they can't do anything if they're not perfect. And I think that is the most, that's just a huge disservice to helping other people and spreading that light and really embodying that energy. That's healing in and of itself.
Yeah, straight up. Yeah, because you'll be on the journey.
Yes.
And then that's all you can do. And
absolutely,
once you're there, it's like, you know, what's that saying? You know, it's like the journey. It's not like the end result.
That's not the destination.
You can't be fixated on that, because if not, you're going to be chasing your tail or something like that.
100%. Yeah.
So if you can let people know if they can get, you know, if they'd like to get in contact with you, maybe ask you questions about your practice or any kind of general things like that, where's like the best places to reach you?
Yeah, just Shaman Activation is pretty much all my ats across all platforms. You can always email me. People reach out to me, I would say, most consistently on TikTok, which is how we met, so it's perfect.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm always here. I do have an online course if anyone wants to learn how to practice shamanism themselves at their own pace. It's really everything you need in one place, which is what I would have killed to have had. So that's there too. But yeah, I'm always available if anyone has any questions. I love talking about it.
So beautiful, man. Yeah, your spirit is so, what's the word? Pristine. You have like a pristine spirit.
So sweet. Right back at you.
Yeah, no, for real. So thank you for talking with me today. You know, I'll have you on definitely for sure in the future if you'd like.
I love that.
Yeah, it'd be very cool.
Thank you so much for having me and for really just opening yourself up. I think it's incredible work that you're doing, and I just feel really grateful to be here and to have met you now.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, well, we're all in our own way. We're all in it together now, right?
Yeah.
And so that's cool, man. It's like, it's a great thing to not feel like alone.
Yes.
In a way, you know, especially with a lot of times people, just the way that they grew up, you know, it was like that. So it's nice to not feel alone, and we're able to learn from each other and get strength from each other. That's cool, man.
Absolutely. So, I think that's what we're here to do.
Yeah. You know, bit by bit as we go, you know.
Yeah. Little by little. That's all you can do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thank you everyone for joining us today on this episode. And I'll be sure to put her notes on the, or put the show notes down on her so you guys can reach her and at least give her a shout out if you don't have any questions. So, all right, guys, I'd like to thank you for another episode, and I will catch you guys on the next one.